Hi, everybody. Hi, everybody. Welcome. You're on Brook Show, Living Objectivism, episode, I don't know, four, something like that. I appreciate everybody listening. Today we have a pretty major task. Now let me just and we'll talk about that in a minute. Let me just note that we are streaming this on Facebook Live and on Periscope and on YouTube. I mean, this will be the standard now. Hopefully, with if the equipment all works and if the setup all makes sense. I'll adjust the camera just a little bit. So you can actually participate in a chat on Blog Talk Radio. You can participate in a chat on Facebook. You can participate on the chat in Periscope. Actually, let me open that up. I don't have that one up open. This is where I need another big live monitor. Maybe I'll get one. We'll see what happens. Launch. All right. We got now the chat from, and you know, some of you might know, we're going to talk about Jordan Peterson today, and some of you might have views and opinions about Jordan Peterson that are maybe even more informed than mine. So to the extent that you guys want to have a conversation, feel free. You can also call in, which is even better. I'll try to monitor the chats, but if you want to call in with comments, I'd appreciate that. 347-324-3075. 347-324-3075. Particularly those of you who've kept track of Jordan Peterson, who've watched some of his videos. And if those of you who are, particularly those of you who are more knowledgeable about philosophy maybe than I am, because, you know, we'll get to it. I think there's a lot of interesting things to talk about. And I have to say, I feel a little, I won't say unprepared, because I'm not sure I could ever be prepared for this this topic. But, you know, this is not my issue. So I feel about like I'm a little above, this is above my grade. My pay grade in terms of dealing with Peterson, and so let me just give you quickly a quick assessment of why I think that. I mean, I think he's an amazing thinker. I think he is smart. I think he knows a lot of stuff, particularly in psychology, but he's also incredibly well read in philosophy. He seems very well read in literature, particularly a certain type of literature. He's very knowledgeable about religion and has very interesting things to say about religion. And don't worry, I've not turned religious. I found it interesting. Yesterday, I did a show about universal basic income. And I'm explaining what it is, and I'm presenting the advantages and disadvantages. And some objectivists were freaking out because they thought, I guess I'd become a socialist because I was presenting the advantages objectively, and I was presenting, you know, it was kind of funny. That's what you're supposed to do. A good educator presents the facts. Anyway, I find Jordan Peterson fascinating and interesting and obviously courageous. We'll get into that. And I just think he has an interesting mind and he has interesting ideas. And even when I disagree with him, he comes at things with an approach that I'm not used to. Now, again, maybe you guys know more. I'm more familiar with, maybe if you're in psychology, you're very familiar with. But to me, you know, I listen to his stuff online and I'm blown away by a lot of it. And we'll get into that. Now, it looks like we've got a caller from overseas because it's a 001011. So let me take the call, even though I'm not quite ready to take calls, but let me take the caller and see where he's going to take us. Hi, you're on the Yaron Brook Show. Who's this?
Hi, this is Shul.
Hey, Shul, speak up because you're coming in pretty softly.
All right. So my question is not about Jordan Peterson, so is it okay if I still ask it? It's about like living objectivism, I guess. It's still like a living objectivism question.
So okay, why don't you ask it, and then I'll see if I answer it or if I delay answering it to the end of the show or to another show.
Okay.
But go ahead and ask.
Okay, so...
All where right, are you so from, by the way? Where's that phone number from?
Hello?
Where are you from, by the way? Where's that phone number from?
This is I'm Indian, but this is from Malaysia. I'm a student in Malaysia.
From Malaysia. Okay. Okay, go ahead.
All right. So it's about friendship and objectivism. So sometimes, like, I talk about, like, objectivist values with my friends.
Yep.
And, you know, some of them are, you know, statists and, you know, and this is basically about two friends of mine. So one is an open socialist. He's asked me to, like, read Karl Marx and whatnot. And I'm still friends with him.
Yep.
Which is a bit odd, you know, like, since he's openly socialist.
Yep.
But there's another friend of mine who is, he's not openly a socialist, but I can sense that he is, like, anti-freedom and whatnot. And I just can't remain friends with him. Like,
yep.
There's something else about him. And this actually reminds me of, I'm reading We the Living for the first time right now.
Yep. Good.
And
that's
this
fun.
Reminds me of, like, Andre and Victor. If you remember the character.
Sure,
and
sure.
Victor is, like, you know, he's kind of two-faced, but Andre is, like, openly communist, and you can, Kira is very openly friends with him. So this is kind of confusing to me. Like, I don't understand what's happening here. Like, it's
okay. Well,
I am friends with my friend, and I like being friends with my communist friend, socialist friend, yeah. But, like, this other friend, I don't like being friends with him. It's really strange.
Well, because there's more. Let me try to deal with this relatively quickly so I can get the Jordan Peterson stuff. But
all right.
I mean, you have to realize that there's more to human relationship than the political ideology that you share. And you have to really evaluate what is it about each one of these guys that I like and that I don't like. And why am I willing to tolerate, in a sense, the socialist? What other values does he possess that I respond to positively? And what, you know, why am I responding so negatively to my other friend who might not be a socialist but is anti-freedom? You can certainly have friendships with people who disagree with you about fundamental issues around politics. I think those friendships in the long run are going to be limited. They're not going to be as deep and as meaningful and as flourishing and as significant to your life as a friendship with somebody who actually agreed with you philosophically. But you can certainly be friends in a context with people who disagree with you about even pretty significant fundamental philosophical issues. And, you know, partially it's an issue of sense mm-hmm. of life, which we can get to another time. And partially it's an issue of particular values that you respond to. And partially it's an issue of the fact that there are just very few people out there who are going to agree with you on philosophy. And human interaction, there's a value in human interaction. And if you limit yourself only to the zero other people in Malaysia who agree with you, you're not going to have much human interaction. So, but the whole issue of friendship is a complex issue. It's not simple. But I think you have to introspect and evaluate the friends and try to understand what values they represent for you. And I think that'll give you clarity as to why you have a response to one and a different response to the other, why you're still willing and why you're still enjoying friendship with one and not with the other. So I think it's worth introspecting and making sure that there's real values there, that there are real objective values that these guys or, you know, these people represent that you're responding to. But yes, I mean, I've had friends, you know, family members, lots of people who I interact with and have relationship with at various levels who don't agree with me in politics or certainly my family disagrees completely with me in politics, you know, but it doesn't stop me from having any kind of relationship. Now, I think a friendship is different than family, but you have to figure out what is it about, what values do they present for you that makes that friendship possible. And I do think you have to accept the fact that friendship is going to be limited as you move into the future. The fact is that you're going to get excited about and pissed off about things that they will not relate to. You'll have fewer and fewer things that you can talk to them about. I think it's going to be very difficult to have lifelong relationship. Although people do it, you know, I can't do it. I couldn't do it. I've never done it. But people have done it. People have married non-objectivists who disagree with them fundamentally on issues. People have friendships with socialists and others. I can't do it. But that doesn't mean you can't do it, right? To me, you know, this is my life. And to think about coming home to a wife who doesn't agree with me or that contradicts what I, you know, what I'm living, you know, what my career is, that's impossible. But again, you have to think for your life, for your values. What are you getting from these relationships? Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
And why don't I commit, because I commit to this all the time and don't follow up, to doing a show on friendship sometime. That would be an interesting show, and it would be a lot of fun to do. So why don't we, this is just like my preliminary thoughts, why don't we just assume that there's going to be a broader conversation down the road? Does that make sense?
All right. I just want to say that I don't base my friendships on politics alone. Like, it is, I think it is much more about like a sense of life thing.
But politics should bug you. If somebody has a really bad political view, a really offensive political view, like socialism, you know, that should bug you. It should. Yeah. The friendship is only going to go so deep because their whole way of looking at the world and the value that they place on individual human beings is going to be limited. The reason Kira can have a relationship with, and his name slipped my mind, of course, the communist is for a brief point in time when he's still honest but ignorant. But as soon as he discovers his ignorance, as soon as he's aware of the ignorance, he has to commit suicide, right?
I'm only halfway through. Please don't spoil it.
What's that? Oh, sorry. Whoops. You didn't hear what I said.
Okay.
All right. Thanks. Thanks for calling. And good luck.
All right. Thank you.
Thanks. All right. All right. So we are back to Jordan Peterson. And as I said, I encourage you to call with your observations or your thoughts or why, if you're interested at all in Jordan Peterson or if he's pissed you off. And I know a lot of people that won't listen to him because he's religious or because whatever. But even religion, he's not religious in the conventional sense. He's religious in an interesting sense, which I find fascinating and challenging in the sense of you have to have arguments against, you know, the arguments he makes for religion. But it's also interesting. We're talking about Jordan Peterson. It's also interesting why somebody that small would be religious. And you can find, you can see the philosophical problem that he's facing, that religion, or at least his interpretation of religion, and he has a very specific type of interpretation of religion. It solves a certain philosophical problem for him, but he's definitely philosophical about it, and we'll talk about that. So there's a ton to talk about, and I'm not sure exactly how to organize all this, but I've got a bunch of random notes about Jordan Peterson that we can talk about. So again, feel free in the various chats, in any of the chats to ask questions or to comment or to give us a call, 347-324-3075. Let's start with just observing why it is that Jordan Peterson has become such a phenomenon and how did he become just a presence everywhere. If you go to YouTube, I mean, his videos, he's got thousands of them and thousands of intellectual videos of deep, you know, meaningful commentary on things. He's not entertaining in a sense of doing stuff that's funny or silly or stupid or anything. This is him lecturing. And every time I look at a video, it's something different. And he has now all his classes being videotaped and they're all being spliced up and put up. And then the spliced up classes are sliced up even more to just have sound bites and they're being put up. And then he's being invited to lecture everywhere and all his lectures are being put up. And then he's doing interviews with everybody from Sam Harris to Mark Stein to all kinds of people, to Dave Rubin. Everybody's interviewing Jordan Peterson. So there's tons, and this is part of my discomfort about even talking about him, I have to admit, but everybody's bugging me, you have to say something about Jordan Peterson, is that you know, I've only listened and watched a fraction of the totality of what he is doing. One of the things that he's doing is a lecture series on the Bible, on the Old Testament. You know, I don't think he's going to get past Genesis from what I'm seeing. He's going kind of chapter by chapter, story by story from the Bible. And he's rented a theater in Toronto, and he is, you know, he is doing 2.5 hour lectures, including Q&A. And people are sitting there, from what I can tell, riveted. This lecture room, massive lecture room, is sold out. He's selling tickets, right? He sold tickets to this series of lectures on the Bible. And it's completely sold out. And not only are people watching it, but then you get hundreds of thousands of hits or tens of thousands of hits on the videos. So there's something going on here. I mean, he is a phenomena right now. But the reason he really kind of rose up and came to awareness of myself, and I think most of the other people, because if you look at most of the interviews, most of the stuff, it's, you know, about a year old. It's relatively new. It's happened relatively fast that he's become such a major intellectual force in our culture. And I consider him definitely that he is a major intellectual force in the culture that one has to deal with. What caused it? Well, what caused it was him standing up for two different things. One was free speech. So there was a bill in Canada, what was it? Bill C-16, I guess, that did a couple of things. One, it gave a variety of different legal protections to, I don't know what you would call it, to a variety of different genders or the ability. And it basically said in this bill that you get to decide what gender you are. And there are multiple genders. There are like 92 different genders or whatever. And it's all completely subjective, and it's your choice. You can define your own gender. Once you do, you become a protected group, a protected minority, like the laws in the U.S. that protect certain minorities. So you get that status. And he rebelled against that. He implicit in this was that there was no relationship between biology and gender, and the gender was a completely 100% subjectivist phenomenon. And then the second thing was that the law basically required that people use either general neutral pronouns or pronouns that reflect this multiplicity of genders. Now, I'd never heard of this stuff. This stuff is completely new to me. And, you know, I don't know if you know this, but some transgender people like to be referred to as Z or Zer, and many of them like to be referred to as they, which I find psychologically fascinating that people would want to be referred to. It reminds me of an anthem. The I disappears and there's only we, but they want to be referred to as they, as if they are the embodiment of some group and there is no individual there. So that's a whole different other issues that regards to this. But basically what Jordan Peterson, stood up against was this notion that he had to follow this, that he couldn't call people he, she, or ask them even, you know, or transgender person who wants to be a she, he could have called she, but no, you're not even allowed to do that. You have to, by law, use this multiplicity of genders and gender neutral. And he spoke up against the idea that the legal system had anything to do with it. And as part of that, he started speaking up against the whole craziness on campus, the new left attack on free speech, the idea that you had to be silenced, and you know, this started with, didn't start with gender, but gender is just one aspect of it. There's the whole issue of race, all these issues, and it suddenly he became an integral part of this if you were a free speech movement, and I really do think that Dave Rubin is a part of, that Sam Harris is a part of, that many of these other intellectuals are part of, and, you know, against the kind of social justice warriors who want to tell you what you can say and what you can't say and why you can say it and why you can't say it. And you really, as somebody who stood up, and particularly the transgender issue, I think, because it's such a tricky issue. It's such a tricky issue because there's so much we don't know. There's so much we don't know. And there's so much that people are going out of their way to try to, you know, try to accept the fact that there are people out there who are really confused and really do feel like they don't belong to the gender that they were born into or that their biology suggests, and that they would like to have a different gender. And I mean, it's a real phenomenon. Whatever we think about it philosophically, whatever we think about it scientifically, there is a psychological issue here. People do feel that. And you don't, there's no reason to disrespect somebody. There's no point in putting somebody down, in offending somebody because they've got, you know, let's say it, you know, I'll say it, some of you will object, a psychological issue, a psychological problem, you know, where their emotions, their psychology, something about the way their mind works is, for whatever reason, and maybe it's hormones, maybe it's a psychological trauma, I don't know, but is inconsistent, clashes with, you know, their biological nature. Now, too many on the social justice side claim that biology is irrelevant. Jordan Peterson talks about this a lot, where he says that the political correct thing to say today is that biology has nothing to do with gender, which is kind of interesting, and that genders are all the same. But of course, there's a contradiction there. If genders are all the same, why do they care so much what pronoun you use? Why do they care so much on how you refer to them? If they're all the same, then it doesn't matter, right? Everything is the same. It's like the feminists have this bizarre thing where they want to be treated different, but they want to claim that they're exactly the same as men, that there's no differences. So I think the idea that there's no biological difference between men, women, is bizarre and ridiculous and anti-reality, anti-scientific, and anti, you know, what one observes and what one experiences. There certainly are differences between men and women. There are biological differences, and the idea that your biological differences do not manifest itself somehow psychologically, do not manifest themselves in the experiences you have in life. Now, that does not say anything about some people, you know, the capacity to reason. It doesn't say anything about intelligence. It doesn't say anything about those things. But it says that there are differences. You know, we respond differently to circumstances, situations, you know, emotionally, psychologically. They have to be differences, given that there are differences in biology. Our, you know, the physical manifestation of being a male and the physical manifestation of being a female are different. The very fact that a female goes through a period, the very fact that a female can, and many females do, get pregnant and give birth, those experiences no male can relate to, those experiences that are profound, they are not irrelevant. Even just the potentiality of getting pregnant and giving birth is substantial. It's not irrelevant to the psychology of a human being. They are biological. Now, do I understand how the biological differences manifest themselves psychologically in men and women? No, I do not. I mean, Ayn Rand had a certain theory of femininity and masculinity, and one, you know, I understand, you know, to the extent that I understand a theory, for the most part, it makes sense to me, but I, you know, my understanding is very limited. You know, we can talk about finance sometime. That I understand, but the psychology of gender, I do not understand. So, but I do know, without any doubt, that men and women are different. I do know, without any doubt, that one's, you know, just like, I'm going to get into trouble, so I'm going to avoid the just like. I think that the physical differences between men and women are so significant that they have to manifest in differences in our psychologies. So beyond that, I'm not gonna speculate more. Maybe when I'm old, I'll speculate more on that. When we do a show about sex or something like that. All right, you can call in and save me right now. 347-324-3075. 347-324-3075. Not seeing many comments, except highs on the verse, except for Stuart, who has like 100 comments on Blog Talk radio chat, but you know, they're too long. And we'll get to a lot of those comments. So that's really what brought him to the forefront. And he was an interesting voice in this whole issue of social justice warriors, the whole issue of free speech, the whole issue of gender, which was made ridiculous by the social justice warriors, the whole issue of this law in Canada that basically restricted speech. Whatever you think about whatever, the idea that that would be in legislation is just bizarre and evil and wrong. And he says, and I think absolutely correctly, that there is the potential that you would be charged. That if in the classroom you refer to somebody by the wrong gender identification, you could be charged. And now, of course, he says that people always say, no, we would never do that. This is just to indicate our intention. But it's in the law. So he says these are slippery slopes, and he's absolutely right about this, that it is fundamentally a slippery slope. Okay, I'm going to – I see a question about Jordan Peterson's relationship to religion. Believe me, we're going to get to that. Right now, I'm just talking about why I think he's reached the prominence. So he was a man who stood up against this, and it took some courage. It took some courage to stand up against these social justice bastards, and it took some courage for a university professor to do it within the context of the university today in Canada, at least, and his university. It really, and he stood up, and he was harassed, and he was discriminated against at the university, and he got into a lot of problems. And he was courageous, and he stood up for free speech, and he speaks up for free speech continuously. And whatever you think about his views, he is a champion of free speech, and he is generally, he doesn't defend free speech like we would. He doesn't defend it philosophically as we would, but he brings it a dimension that I think is interesting and important, and I think woke up a lot of people. I think he was willing to say things about psychology that I can't say, that I don't think Sam Harris is necessarily qualified to say, that a lot of people say. So he's the psychologist, if you will, that stood up and spoke. And he knows, at least my senses, he really knows the stuff. He knows the studies. He knows the thinkers. He knows this stuff. So I think it gave everything instant credibility when he spoke up. So give him a lot of credit for doing that and speaking up against and taking the risks and fighting these social justice bastards. All right, we got a caller. Hi, you're on the Yaron Brook Show. Who's this?
Hi, it's Jennifer, Michigan.
Hey, Jennifer, how's it going?
Good, how are you?
Good. Go ahead.
I wanted to talk about the religion aspect.
Sure, you can start us off.
I heard him on a video talking about the psychological reasons why people need religion to be moral.
Yep.
And he was saying that they need the threat or the reward of heaven or hell after they die so that they'll behave themselves.
Yep.
And I was wondering why he would think they would need that. I would think that you'd be more motivated by a threat or reward in your life on earth rather than waiting till you die, especially for a young person. They're not going to worry about what happens when they're 80 or after they die. I wonder what psychological motivation he would think that would provide anybody. It doesn't make sense to me.
Well, because he doesn't quite see, I don't think, he quite sees the reward and the punishment right here on earth. So there is a real question of that religionists struggle with, of why do evil people do very well and seem to do very well? And why do good people, why don't the Nazis kill millions of good people, basically decent people who did nothing and yet suffer and die? And generally, Peterson places a huge significance to human suffering. So, and I'll talk about that. This is his existentialist. He's got a great sympathy to the existentialist philosophers. And he thinks that to some extent, human meaning, life's meaning comes from suffering. And that much of life is about mitigating suffering. But the essential, the thing that's most real, that's most there, is suffering. Now, why he would think that, you know, where that comes from, partially it comes from looking at the world and looking at reality and looking at the fact that so many millions of people are suffering, and that human history is filled with human suffering, and that suffering, much more than flourishing, has dominated human history. And to him, he would say that suffering is ingrained in us, that idea of suffering is much more ingrained in us. So therefore, because life sucks, right? Because life, for the most part, is miserable, it's suffering, it's the only way to relieve, or one way to relieve that, I don't think you would say the only way, one way to relieve that, one way to deal with that is by believing in an afterlife, right? And you can see that, yeah. You can see the temptation of that. You can see the temptation of telling your child when things are going, you know, let's say, telling your child when things are going bad, or you're dying, or you know, he's just witnessed some horrible thing, or he's witnessed other people dying that are close, or lots of people dying. The whole idea of an afterlife is very pleasing psychologically. It's very easy and relieves a huge amount of burden and a huge amount of stress on people. You know, you say, don't, you know, yeah, it's too bad this person's gone, but don't worry, we'll meet up in heaven, right? I mean, that's so easy.
Yeah.
And that's so psychologically, I don't know, liberating, right? In some sense, right? There's more to this than just the 80 years that we're on this planet. And there is, I mean, this is the thing that Jordan Peterson and all thinkers struggle with. Kind of, what is the meaning of life? What's the point? Why are we here? You know, why are 7 billion people here when many of them, if not most of them, are suffering to some extent or another? What's the point of it all, right? And these are the kind of questions philosophers think about. These are the kind of questions psychologists think about. This is the kind of question that any thinking human being thinks about. And unless you're a genius like Ayn Rand, it's not easy to answer that question, right? And religion, and this is why Ayn Rand said that religion was a primitive form of philosophy, because it is. It gives you a certain philosophical view on that. It's pretty primitive. It's pretty unsophisticated, although people like Jordan Peterson and others try to make it more sophisticated than the Pope would. It reminds me a little bit of a Jewish rabbi, because the Jewish rabbis can be very sophisticated in their understanding of religion and their understanding of the psychological and philosophical need that people have for religion, or for answers, or for direction, or for meaning in life, right? For meaning and purpose, right? And think about how central Ayn Rand puts purpose. Well, she can only do that, or that gains currency, if you will, that gains meaning, only because she's got a whole moral theory in which that fits, and you see it can fit very neatly in it. But if you don't have a whole moral theory, then you need to fit purpose in somehow. And you know, I guess the easiest way to fit purpose in is to project it into infinity, and project it into another life, and project it into an afterlife. So I think psychologically, it's very appealing to do that, and very appealing for people to get sucked into it. And this is why religion has part of why religion has such a hold on people. And we'll get to why he thinks that you need religion in order to have morality. It's not just the issue of heaven and hell. I think there's more. I mean, he can't see the bridging of the Is-Odd gap. He can't see kind of Nietzsche's attitude of, if God is dead, then anything goes. He can't argue himself out of the nihilist position if God doesn't exist. And to him, God is not, it's a sophisticated idea. It's not a typical Judeo-Christian God who's looking over and examining us. It's a different idea of what a God is. But he can't really resolve the issue of nihilism. I mean, and he can't, he has, and you see this when he talked to Sam Harris, he really has, he can't bring himself to accept that, you know, you can discover truth out there that is then meaningful for making your life a flourishing life. I mean, he has a whole idea of what is flourishing, how do we even know what flourishing is, and certainly he has a problem with telling other people what flourishing is, because he says the only way to measure flourishing, I'm gonna take you offline. Thanks for calling. Unless you have another
Thank
question.
You.
Yeah, let me just make this point. He says, how do we measure human well-being? I mean, we don't know how to measure human well-being. So what are we talking about with human well-being? He says the only way we have to measure human well-being today is extroversion minus neuroticism equals well-being. And since we can't measure all of that, and we don't even know that that's really what well-being is, but that's the best we can do, then how do you even measure that? There's no point in talking about well-being in this sense, because can't measure it. If you can't measure it, it doesn't really exist. And so he's got I don't know. I mean, again, I'm sympathetic because to some extent, because he's approaching this at least pseudoscientifically, right? He's trying to get a handle on what is this well-being, and he's struggling with is ought, and he can't get how you get from this is reality. And he has a strange view of reality, which comes from his view of God, I can learn from reality and come to moral conclusions from reality. And that's hard, right? Again, it took Ayn Rand, a genius, to bridge the is ought gap. So it's not surprising that so many intellectuals out there can't do it. And what he's saying is, in a sense, the only other solution to having morality, if I can't bridge the is ought gap and I don't want to be a nihilist, is to accept that there's something intrinsic in the world that represents the good. And he's an intrinsicist. So he's the counter to subjectivism, which is intrinsicism. It's out there. It's there. And it's just upon us to discover it. So truth and everything is there in the things themselves. Morality is there in what he considers God. And it's the whole evolution of religion for him, the Old Testament, the New Testament, and all of human knowledge and human history, is this process of discovering what's there in the thing itself, the unveiling of the truth. And it takes a long, long time to do that, to discover it, not discover it in the sense that we mean, but discovering reality, but discovering what's in the value that's in the thing itself, not the value as corresponds to human consciousness and our needs of survival. But it's just, we have to look, and we somebody else can describe intrinsicism better than I can, I'm sure. Hopefully among one of these callers, I've got four now on the line. So, okay, so you guys really want to talk about Jordan Peterson, which is good. So he's definitely an intrinsicist, and God to him, in a sense, is the truth. And discovering the truth is discovering God. And he views the Old and New Testament as metaphors. Jesus as, how did he describe him? I had it here. Jesus is a meta-hero, right? As a meta-hero. And he views the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, again, as all metaphors for this thing that we need. Because if it doesn't exist, truth doesn't exist. And if truth doesn't exist, then, oh my God, it's chaos. And he talks a lot about chaos. Chaos is big for him. Chaos is the evil. Chaos is destruction. Chaos is the negation of everything. Chaos is the zero. And think about the Bible, right? The Bible is what the first thing God does is makes order out of chaos. And to him, making order out of chaos is what life is about and what epistemology is about. And it's discovering the order that's there, that God has put in there, that is in reality, that's what it, and there's a truth to that, right? There's a truth to that. And unless we engage our consciousness, unless we discover the laws, it's all the laws of physics or the laws of reality. And this, you know, it's chaos out there. There's nothing out there. And he associates chaos with nihilism. And he's a huge, he hates nihilism. He finds nihilism as the real, as the force behind social justice warriors, as the force behind the new left, as incredibly destructive. And he is rebelling. He is a rebel against the nihilism that is rising up on our university campuses and all around us in the world. And that he sees has arisen since the rejection of religion, since religion was rejected, since God was rejected. But I think since the rejection of an intrinsicist worldview in favor of what he sees as a complete subjectivist worldview, right? But so it's interesting because he's anyway, it's let's take some calls and then we'll dig further and hopefully these calls will help us do that. Hi, you're on the Yaron Brook Show. Who's this?
Good evening, Dr. Brook. This is Skylar.
Hey, Skylar. So what do you have to say about Jordan Peterson?
In relation to religion more so, I'm not going to really discuss too much about Jordan Peterson. I just wanted to, since you brought up the topic of religion.
Sure.
I just wanted to see the relationship between religion and racism.
You know, I don't know, and it depends on religion. I think that certainly Christianity is an attempt at universality, and so is Islam. So both Islam and Christianity are universal religions. Anybody can become them. It's fairly easy to adopt a religion. It doesn't require much. You basically have to say some prayers and bring Jesus into your heart or whatever. Many people have tried to get me to do that. And they clearly articulate that it doesn't matter what race you are. Although Christians viewed and claimed to have justification in the Bible, they viewed blacks, for example, as subhuman, as animals. And they claim to base it on their religion, but I don't know enough about that issue to argue that it's there. Christianity is definitely an attempt to universalize, and really it's a religion of the underdog, right? I mean, Christianity is all about turn the other cheek and the meek shall inherit the earth is that the Christians were meek. They were. You know, they were being oppressed. They were people who had no political or economic power in the Roman Empire. And they were the meek. And they looked at the world from the perspective of the meek. I mean, I don't think Jesus says to Caesar unto Caesar and to God unto God because he's a believer in the separation of church and state. He's a believer in the separation of church and state because he knows the political ramification of having a different position given the Roman Empire's existence and rule. So he says, look, if we're going to survive, if Christianity is going to survive, we have to give to Caesar what is Caesar's. We have to have this separation to some extent, right? Islam is a religion of success. It's a religion of conquest. It's a religion of prosperity. The founders of the Islamic religion were rich. They were traders. They were winning. They were conquering. There was absolutely no reason to separate state from church because their religion manifest in their army, which is the state, was winning all the battles. So why separate them? We're going to use Islam to dominate the world. Which for a while they almost did. So religions kind of grew up in different ways and manifest themselves both in the holy books and in the psychology of the people holding it. This is why I think Muslims have a lot more confidence because it's built into kind of, they win, or they have won in the past. And part of the psychology of the Middle East, part of the psychology of Muslims is, hey, why are we losing now? Why are we so pathetic now? And that goes to part of the frustration within the Muslim world is, wait a minute, Allah promised us the success. We were succeeded for hundreds of years, and now we're total disasters. In a sense, Christianity never had that. It had it a little bit, but as soon as the Romans adopt Christianity as their religion, very quickly afterwards, they fall. And Christianity's never, in the name of Christianity, been a dominant political force. Now, Judaism is more complicated. So I don't know. I mean, I'm sure there's a relationship because certainly Judaism is tribal, and there's, but Christianity's trying to abandon the tribalism of Judaism. It's trying to go broader. I don't know. Again, if there's somebody more familiar with the history of religion and its relationship with racism, I'm open to other ideas on this. All right, that makes sense, Skylar?
Yes, sir. Thank you, Dr. Brooker. I appreciate it.
Sure, but I still think that you cannot really get rid of slavery, and therefore you cannot really get rid of racism until you have a truly individualistic philosophy. So there was still slavery, and there was certainly still racism throughout the Christian epochs, right? It's only the Enlightenment, with its emphasis on human individual reason and its emphasis on the individual as the moral agent, and the idea of individual rights that ultimately destroys racism. Still hasn't destroyed it completely, but that's because the Enlightenment never really fully won and destroyed slavery. The abolition of slavery is a huge achievement of the Enlightenment. Of the Enlightenment. Right. All right. Right. Let's get next caller. Hi, you're on the Yaron Brook Show. Who's this?
Hi, this is Tyler from Oregon.
Hey, Tyler. So, Jordan Peterson.
I wanted to just briefly... Yeah.
Go ahead.
Okay. I was just going to briefly comment on something another caller said, that I think that Jordan Peterson doesn't believe people believe in like God and Christianity because they want to go to heaven. He actually, because he points out that, you know, Christians argue for the existence of hell as well, and so they wouldn't find that particularly comforting. I think he argues that people believe in God because it explains the universe. It gives them a sense of understanding about the world. And I think that's accurate.
Yeah.
But I think I wanted to ask you.
Yeah.
About,
let me just comment on that, and then I'll let you ask me a question. I agree with you completely. So yes, Jordan Peterson, and actually the person asking the question didn't make the point that they believe in God because of it, that they adopt a Christian morality because of it. So morality has a hold on people. Because whether they get rewarded or punished in this life, they're doing it for the sake of another life. And I think that's true. I think the afterlife was invented by Christianity. Judaism doesn't have it. In order to explain the problem of, the problem of evil, the problem of evil people succeeding in this life and the problem of good people suffering in this life. So they invented a hell and a heaven. Hell for the bad people who seem to be successful in this life, don't worry, they're not going to be successful in the next. And a heaven for the people who seem to be struggling in this life, don't worry, they'll succeed in the next life, they go to heaven. So it's morality that heaven and hell are trying to deal with. The Jews have a real hard time with these issues of why do 6 million Jews die in a Holocaust? They didn't do anything wrong. And there's no afterlife, so it's a dead end. Why would God let this happen? Christianity solves that problem by creating a heaven and hell. But I agree with you. Most people adopt religion because it answers metaphysical and epistemological and ethical questions that they need answers for. And this is the sense in which Ayn Rand called it a primitive religion, a primitive philosophy. And she also makes the point very eloquently in Philosophy Who Needs It and many other places that every human being needs a philosophy. We need guidance. And we need conceptual guidance, and religion provides conceptual guidance. I mean, I would argue not very good conceptual guidance, dramatically flawed conceptual guidance, but in some way emotionally quite appealing conceptual guidance and that's what people are seeking. So I agree with you. Go ahead, but you had a question.
Yeah, I think that's right. And I'm a big fan of Jordan Peterson, and particularly his lectures about psychology and philosophy. I would say my biggest disagreement with him is on his pragmatist epistemology. And I think that is what brings him to believing in God, because he definitely takes this metaphorical view of God. And he argues that, you know, to a certain extent, the primitive philosophy of religion managed to stabilize society and bring a sense of understanding of the world that worked well enough early in mankind's history. I was wondering what you thought of this interpretation of God as a sort of, and he definitely describes him as a sort of personification of concepts that people didn't understand, things like, and he uses God as synonymous with reality, order, and truth.
Yep.
And I think that it definitely what he argues is that people personify these ideas in God, and the way that worked is that it set him at the top of the hierarchy. So God was above everything. And so it was harder to argue that you have to correspond to reality, but you could say, okay, well, you could obey God.
Yep.
And I was wondering what your thoughts on that was.
Well, I mean, I think everything you said is spot on in terms of representing, you know, Jordan Peterson. And let me just say something quickly about hierarchy. I do find it very positive in Peterson that he talks a lot about hierarchies of values. And he talks a lot about that people should have hierarchies of values and should make them explicit and should strive towards achieving the higher values. And of course, at the top of that hierarchy of values is God, is truth, is order. And he's right. You're right. He uses truth and order. He views the metaphysical world as chaos versus order, truth versus falsehood. And he's big on truth. And when he, you know, there's so many good things about him that drives me nuts, because he's got some lectures about truth and why you shouldn't lie and why you should be honest that are fantastic. I mean, he talks about what truth does to you what lying does to you psychologically, and why evasion and why rejection why telling lies is so destructive. And it's almost objectivism. It's not quite, but it's almost objective. It's about the best I've heard from a non-objectivist in terms of the damaging consequences of being dishonest. And there's a lot. Again, I love listening to his stuff because there's a lot I can glean out of it. In spite of that. But look, what do I think of it? I think it's wrong. I think it's the best interpretation of God you can think of. I think it's the best view of religion one can imagine. But it's wrong. And again, you know, maybe somebody with more knowledge of the history of philosophy. I don't think it's particularly original to Jordan Peterson. I think this probably goes back to Plato. It strikes me as very Platonic and probably goes back to the Greeks. And this is, to me, a big hole in Jordan Peterson's, I don't know, education, but in his presentation, is he never talks about the Greeks, which I find strange. I mean, Western civilization to him is the Judeo-Christian tradition and on. And I haven't seen him, and maybe I've just missed out. I haven't seen him talk about Plato and Aristotle and all the Greek philosophers. I mean, and all about the Homer and the Greek myths. He's big on mythology and the importance of mythology. And I think he's onto something. I think mythology is very important and serves an important cultural function, including the mythology of the Old and New Testament. And I'm fascinated by his lectures on that and what he has to say about that, because I think it says a lot about Judaism and Christianity. The way he talks about it, I think you could learn a lot about Judaism and Christianity's approach to these issues. But I think that, you know, he has this, you know, almost world of forms view of finding somehow enlightenment in reaching truth, in finding God, in finding order, that is I think very Platonic. Now, because he's also an evolutionary psychologist, I mean, I wouldn't be surprised, or talks a lot about evolution. You know, there's probably some Kantian stuff in there. There are probably some categorical imperatives, even though he doesn't recognize them, that it's what we're discovering are the imperatives. I don't know. I don't know that deeply, but there's something of that nature in everything that he does. I mean, and you know, there's also something anyway. So obviously, I think he's wrong, and there's a sense in which he's a primacy of consciousness because this consciousness is, and he talks about this in one of his talks. He says, it's meaningless to talk about reality independent of consciousness. It's meaningless to talk about a physical world independent of the observer. And he's very much on this. And of course, the ultimate observer, if you will, the ultimate consciousness is God. And we're all our consciousness is part of this greater consciousness. I've heard this so many times from people. Again, he's not original in this. He's just a really good articulator of this. A lot of Jewish rabbis talk like this. And I think a lot of philosophers have him in the past. Does that answer your question? I don't know if I have or not.
Yeah, and that answers it. And I definitely think he is he definitely values truth. I think his fundamental mistake is that he views the truth as what's practical I think it's backwards. It's practical because it's true. But
So is that what you mean by his pragmatist epistemology, that he is, because I think he has a mixed epistemology, yeah. Right? It's a mixture. It's the truth is what works, but there's also truth out there, right? That somehow needs to be revealed to us, and properly reading and understanding the metaphors of the Old Testament and New Testament will reveal those truths. So it's not purely a pragmatic view; it's also a kind of Platonic view of truth.
I'm not sure if it's entirely revealed, but I think that's interesting.
Yeah.
But thanks for taking my call.
Sure. My pleasure. Thanks for calling. And thanks for listening. All right. We got a ton of callers. Hi, you're on the Yaron Brook Show. Who's this?
Thanks for taking my call. Sure. My pleasure. Thanks for calling.
All right. I can hear you listening to the show on some other platform. Yeah. You have to turn that off.
Hi, you're on the Yaron Brook
Show. Hello. 304's area code. All right, I'm putting you on hold, but you've got the show on whatever it is you're listening to, and it's lagged. I can hear myself talk what I said a few seconds ago, and you went off, so you hung up. Okay, we're going to take this call. Hi, you're on the Yaron Brook Show.
Hello?
Yep, we can hear you.
Hey, good. Yeah, I just wanted to comment on, you asked at the start,
name and where
you're
from.
Jordan Peterson, it became so popular.
Yeah, go ahead.
And I think a big part of it is just kind of going back, you know, all the way to like Aquinas, and that when he reads into religion and he talks about religion as a kind of a, what is the word he used? Like a guiding principle, a guiding organizing principle.
Yep.
He does it in such a way that it's very, you know, and he's very articulate about a scientific way to incorporate religion into people's lives to make it more than just an authority figure from above telling you what to do. And that, you know, that's appealing to people who fundamentally still don't recognize reason as a fundamental principle in your life. And I just think that's my thought on why he's particularly popular now, and that, you know, pretty much everything you hear is straight up just nihilism or authority figures, and here's somebody who's articulate and intelligent saying,
and
you know, that there is an organizing principle, and it, but it just happens to be, you know, the guy in the sky sort of thing.
I think that's right, but also it's that he's not turning their world upside down. So he's accepting their Christianity. He's accepting, you know, so he's not challenging people on their religion. But what he's doing is he's given it what would seem like, and what he presents at, a more philosophical, reasoned, rational perspective on it, and trying to explain it to them rather than, just preach it to them, right? And I think people are responding positively to it, and I think the fact that they're responding to it is a good sign. I don't think it's a bad sign. But it is people latching on to, they want God and he's giving them the rationalizations for it. They want the morality. But he has a weird, even his view of morality, you know, the hints of altruism there, but he's not an altruist. Certainly not in the full sense of the word. So,
I would,
yeah, go ahead.
I've listened to a couple hundred hours of his lectures since this whole thing kind of broke in October, and I think the more that you listen to him talk about morality, the more he's thought about it. And just in my interpretation of listening to him, he seems to, you know, because he is stuck in like an ethical loop of, you know, where does this question of ethics go?
Yes.
And he keeps coming back to this altruism. And to me, it seems like his views on morality have actually moved towards altruism more than away from it. But again, I agree. It's a very convoluted ethical system that he has in his mind.
And I'm not surprised.
He doesn't understand.
I'm not surprised because I see him struggling with the idea of individual human flourishing and wanting to strive towards individual human flourishing and wanting individuals to have hierarchies of values that lead them towards that. But then he can't, because he can't actually come up with why would individuals want to flourish? And he can't come up with the izzard. He can't, okay, what are the values that they should strive towards to achieve human flourishing other than minimize pain, minimize suffering, and minimize neuroticism, right? Minimize the neurotic. So I think you're right. I think what happens is he's drawn by the kind of Aristotelian idea of morality is there to improve the individual and to live a better, flourishing, kind of happy life. But he can't answer the question of why, partially because he doesn't have objectivism. And therefore he gets stuck with going back to the altruism because it's the only alternative there is. And, you know, it's interesting. He talks about sacrifice, right? He talks a lot about sacrifice. But when he actually gives examples of sacrifice, they're never examples of actual sacrifice. So all his examples which relate to sacrifice have to do with delayed gratification. So sacrificing, as in his term, sacrificing the present for the future. And that's not sacrifice. That's investment, right? So you know, you might invest in something today, and spend a lot of time on it, knowing that the reward will only come sometime in the future. That's what it means to be conceptual, almost the ability to think long term, right? But to him, somehow he presents that as if it's sacrifice, and he can't get away from that language, which is surprising because he's a smart guy. Anyway, so
it'd
I think he struggles. He struggles
about
with this.
His views on Cain. I know he's doing that Old Testament series when he gets to Cain and Abel, how that would relate to. I think that'd be illustrative on his views of sacrifice and what that means for human morality. I think that'd be a very illustrative.
Yes. I did that. I'm in the middle of the Garden of Eden, which I find really interesting listening to his Garden of Eden stuff. But yes, I think part of the Cain and Abel is also his belief in conflict and the fact that conflict is part of life and almost a metaphysical part of life. So he's a confusing thinker, but I find very interesting. He has interesting psychological observations that I seem to learn a lot from, even though philosophically he is thoroughly wrong. His metaphysics are bad, his epistemology is bad, and his ethics are bad. And he's a conservative when it comes to politics. He's certainly not. But it's amazing to me how somebody that smart can be that bad at the same time. And he's read Ayn Rand, and he has a very positive view of the novels because I think he responds to the superhero, the John Galt, he responds to the hierarchy of values. He responded emotionally, but I don't think he's ever read the philosophy, and I don't think he took the philosophical issues brought up in Atlas Shrugged seriously, and he certainly didn't integrate them. Or maybe that's what keeps tugging at him in terms of why he is attracted sometimes to the less altruistic moral views.
If you read some of his Twitter posts or people have asked him about Ayn Rand, what he says about literarily, you know, the characters is that they're almost too one-dimensional and that they're presented as, you know, thoroughly good.
Yep.
And you know, there's no nuance in the good versus evil. And I think that's, again, a confusion where he views morality as a mitigation of suffering or evil instead of a life-affirming force.
Yeah, but it's also
in someone's life,
the good. I mean? The good is Jesus, and the good is God. So the good is manifest in God, and we as human beings cannot be the good. We as human beings are necessarily flawed. So, I mean, that's part of his inability to see the heroes in Atlas Shrugged as heroes, because they're not Jesus, right? So they have to be flawed. There has to be a flaw there because they're not God, right? And so it's, that's what partially, I think, what he's challenged with in order to do that. But again, sophisticated, complex, wrong, but interesting. I had a thought, but it escaped me. Good. Well, thanks for the call. And you know, it's really easy to get caught up in listening to hundreds of hours of Jordan Peterson. I hope you're getting something out of it. So don't make it an obsession. And don't get caught up in his own, confusions. We've got enough of our own confusions not to get too involved in Jordan. But if you want to confront your ideas with, some of the best opposition, I'd say he's the guy to talk to. Though it would be interesting to have him and an objectivist philosopher actually debate some of these philosophical issues. I think that would be fascinating and really interesting. And I suspect that what I enjoy about Peterson, Sam Harris, Dave Rubin, a lot of these people, is the indication that there's an audience for what they have to say. Because no matter what you think at the end of Jordan Peterson, the fact that so many people are interested in listening, I think is a good indication. This is intellectual stuff. This is not the garbage that goes for intellectual stuff on some university campuses. It's not the garbage that goes to some intellectual stuff, some videos on YouTube and cat videos and whatever. Here's people really, really talking about real issues in an intelligent way with vast, I mean, this is the thing. I think I said this early on about Jordan Peterson. He knows history. He knows philosophy. He knows psychology. And he's integrating them all. And it's fascinating to watch. Agree or disagree, it's fascinating to watch. And in a pro-values way, he's not a nihilist. He's the contrary. He's trying to escape. He's trying to fight off nihilism. So, I would love to see, one of our philosophers really get into a deep debate with him. And it would be good for some of our philosophers to comment on some of the philosophical issues they see with Jordan. I think it would get them a lot of visibility on Facebook, on YouTube and other places if they took on Peterson on some of the philosophical flaws, mistakes, problems that he has, and provide answers to them, better answers that I'm providing here to a different audience. I'm speaking to mostly objectivists and mostly people who agree with me, but to a general audience, that would be, that would be terrific. So objectivist philosophers out there, I think we'd get a lot of publicity for objectivism if that were done. So Ankar, Greg Salamieri, I think that would be right up there, Ali. All right, we got one more caller. Hi, you're on the Yaron Brook Show. Who's this?
Aloha, it's Stuart.
Hey, Stuart. It took you long enough
to
call.
Beg your pardon?
Nothing. Go ahead. Go ahead.
Yeah. I want to mention that, and this relates to what you said earlier about dialogue, because I noticed that Jordan Peterson has repeatedly recommended very enthusiastically a book on the history of philosophy by a professor who is well known for being sympathetic to Ayn Rand, that's Explained Postmodernism by Stephen Hicks from Oxford University, And Stephen Hicks doesn't make it a secret, that he is very influenced by Ayn Rand. But Jordan Peterson has never, I don't think he's elaborated exactly on why he likes that book. So it's very confusing to me because I haven't gotten to reading it yet, but from the synopses I keep seeing, Stephen Hicks actually attributes postmodernism to Hume and Kant.
Yes.
So he blames a lot of it ultimately on Hume and Kant.
Well, I think that in the context, Jordan Peterson might agree. That is, again, Peterson is not a consistent Kantian or consistent anything. He's to some extent, there's a hodgepodge of ideas there that he's trying to make sense of. And you can tell as he's lecturing, sometimes he's trying to make sense of them as he's talking because he doesn't have it down yet. I think he read Stephen Hicks's book and particularly responded to Hicks's attack on postmodernism. But also Hicks does a very good job of outlining how we got from Kant to Marx to in a sense, the rejection of Marx because Marxism had failed to postmodernism. And one of the things that Hicks does is he doesn't just talk about the philosophical chain. He also talks about the psychological chain. He also talks about why it was that the Marxists, when they realized what had happened in the Soviet Union and how bad things were, turned to postmodernism in order, in a sense, as an escape. So they rejected all knowledge. They rejected all truth. They became nihilists as a consequence. And he discusses that psychologically, Stephen Hicks does. And there's some really good stuff. You can look it up. You can get the book, but you can also look it up online. There's some good lectures by him on this postmodernism stuff. I can see why Jordan Peterson would see that and responds favorably because, again, he is not anti, he is pro-values. He believes in order out of chaos. And the postmodernists are chaos and they're lying about reality and they're lying about the truth that's in reality. I wouldn't say objectivity because I don't think Jordan Peterson really recognizes the concept of objectivity. Again, I think he's in the subjectivist intrinsicist. So he rejects postmodernism for being the subjectivist that they are, but he adopts an intrinsicist view. And, you know, I think when he reads Stephen, he can see the progression and he buys into it. That doesn't prevent him from them adopting a certain parts of the methodology of, let's say, a Kant or something. Right. So, again, the way people apply philosophy, that's a whole interesting topic. How do people actually integrate philosophy and apply it and integrate it into their belief system? And Peterson is primarily a psychologist and he's a Jungian psychology, J-U-N-G. I know nothing about Jung's psychology. So I know nothing. And he knows a lot. He talks a lot about Freud. He's an admirer of Freud. So there is a mess there. There's so much going on. He's a psychologist who's trying to be a philosopher and to comment on the culture and explain history. And again, you have to admire him for being ambitious, but it's going to be a mishmash, and some of the mishmash is going to be good stuff. And yeah, the Stephen Hicks postmodernism stuff is good stuff.
Well, you know, it confuses me a lot because it seems to me that he fundamentally agrees with Hume and Kant that ultimately, inductive reason, observational reason, is not adequate. It can't tell you absolute truth. You know, you can't get morality from it. It's not good enough. So to me, in the end, he is a skeptic after all.
Yeah, but you see, philosophy doesn't manifest itself in people in that way. It's not like you're a Kantian, therefore you're Hitler. You know, people take some of that, and then in other parts of their lives, like in his psychology, he's an absolutist. He knows what's true, and he accepts that truth. I mean, it's true that every intrinsicist is subjectivist ultimately, because he has to get the truth from somewhere, and emotions in the end are the only place to get it. So you have to mix up some reality, and he does use objective reasoning constantly. If you look at this stuff on psychology and you look at how he analyzes things, I mean, he says some stuff on psychology that I think is absolutely brilliant and I agree with completely. But people are not, all right, I've adopted this philosophy, therefore this is the outcome that's going to happen. That's not how it works. People are mixtures of a lot of things and they're not just manifestation of one line. And I can hate Kant and yet have a Kantian view of the world. I can reject Kant's epistemology and yet have ingrained pieces of that epistemology into my own epistemology. So he can be anti-Kant and anti-human, anti-subjectivism, and yet be a subjectivist to some extent. Contradictions are everywhere, you know, and they live in human beings. They live in human beings all the time. And to the extent that they are contradictions, they suffer the consequences of those contradictions. And he cannot achieve real knowledge of truth what he wants to achieve, which is real knowledge of truth, because he's torn between contradictions. But he is not a skeptic, and a skeptic in the same sense as modern skeptics are. Or even he wouldn't explain his skepticism in the same way Hume explains it.
Well, I do think it's a good precedent that, you know, he liked Stephen Hicks's book, and, you know, and he has this dialogue going on. I was curious, you think this might mean he might be willing to have a dialogue with, say, you?
I think he'd be willing to have that dialogue. I don't think he's going to change. Again, I mean, this is a guy who's thought about this, integrated those ideas into a system he believes in. It's an integrated system. It's a misintegration, but it's an integrated system. You know, and it's founded on certain psychological observations, which he is deeply, deeply committed to, because he is a psychologist and he knows that literature and he studied it and he knows the empirical evidence and he thinks the empirical evidence and everything else justifies his philosophical conclusions. I don't think you're going to change Jordan Peterson's mind about fundamental philosophical issues. And that's not why I would suggest a debate. The only reason I suggest a debate is to use his platform to reach a lot of the people listening to him, because a lot of the people listening to him, I think are, you know, I think are interesting people and people we can reach. So no, you know, don't assume that he can change, because I don't think he can. I think very few people beyond a certain age change, and the more intellectual they are, the less they change. It's very hard. He spent, in his 50s probably, he spent 50 years integrating a particular system that he is clearly unequivocally committed to. And it's full of contradictions, but I don't think his psychology can accept a reject. Now, you know, people have free will. I could be wrong, but I think the challenge of somebody like that accepting the contradictions that exist there, I think are probably just too great. Anyway, that's my view. It's hard to speculate on other people's ability to change their free will and so on. But that's where we are. I mean, so let me. We've got about 10 minutes or 13 minutes, and I'm still open. Thanks, Stuart. Thanks for calling. I'm still open for calls if you want to call. Now, remember, if you call, you have to press the 1 so that I know that you're not just calling to listen to the show, but you're calling to actually ask a question. So if you press 1, I get a little question mark over here. And I can do that. 347-324-3075. Just generally, I encourage you to follow me on Facebook and Twitter and SoundCloud and YouTube and I don't know everything else. I don't have Snapchat, so you don't have to follow me in Snapchat. I mean, it would be interesting if some of you knew something about Jungian psychology, because I know nothing about it. But it, you know, somebody here in the chat says that it's fundamentally mystical. I guess I wouldn't be surprised, but it depends what you mean by fundamentally mystical. Hi, you're on the Yaron Brook Show. Who's this?
Hi, it's Will, Yaron.
Is that Will? I couldn't quite capture your name.
Yeah, it's Will.
Will. Go ahead, Will.
I really enjoy your shows, and I've listened to a lot of Jordan Peterson's videos and lectures and lots of different things I like to say, but basically what I like to think of him is like a traditionalist. Like he likes tradition. So when people latch on to gender issues that he talks about, I think that like he worries that everything's going to decay into chaos.
Why do you think he likes tradition?
Gulag, archipelago.
Why do you think he likes tradition?
Well, he thinks that, and I've noticed this with Douglas Murray, who wrote The Strange Death of Europe, like with about Islamic, like with migration and that. They think that if there's no religion, that, you know, like there's no structure, like morality, ethics. And when he looks at gender things sort of dissolving, like he talks to one of the five personality types, and he said that he likes order and stuff like that. And I think that he looks everywhere and sees like,
chaos.
Any reduction in tradition. Like he talks about marriage should be man and woman, and women should have kids and all that kind of thing. And that bothers me a lot, all that type of thing.
Yeah, but he has some interesting psychological things to say about women and men and working long hours and what it takes to kind of have a high stress jobs and stuff, which I find interesting. I don't agree with him, but it's fascinating. But I think he's a traditionalist, and I, you know, this is kind of a Hayekian. Hayek was the same way. He views tradition as a sense evolutionary. So tradition has weeded out the bad stuff. Because certain institutions, like marriage, let's say, between a man and woman, have survived for 2,000 years, it means it must be good. It's serving a certain function for society to be able to function. So he values tradition because it has been tested, right? This goes to kind of the pragmatism. It's been tested. It works. And we know it works because it survived. And if it survived, it must be good. And this is part of his argument for religion. Religion must be good because it survived, because everybody has it, because it exists in the East and the West, and every continent has religion. So therefore, it must serve a crucial human function. He can't abstract away from that to philosophy. But instead, he abstracts away to the idea of God has to be there. But he's a traditionalist because it provides order. His biggest fear, both psychologically and philosophically, is chaos, you know, and this is why he hates the nihilist, because the nihilist's whole purpose in life is to bring about chaos. It's to destroy order, and tradition is established order. And and it's terrible, but there are glimpses of truth in there, right? Go ahead.
You mentioned sacrifice earlier. He actually, because I've watched a ton of his stuff. He actually mentioned, like, he justifies everything, like you said, with tradition and, like, well, it was important and that's what they knew at the time. And, like, he talked about farmers killing animals, like, as an animal sacrifice, which would be something valuable to that farmer.
Yep.
And to me, that's really sick when you start to justify even human or animal sacrifice because it's something valuable to you. And it goes in with all the religion. And that's why I'm saying, like,
is he justifying or explaining it?
Was human. Well, I mean,
he's doing both.
He explains it to me. I interpret. Yeah. I mean, he's sort of saying that's what they did because that's what they had at the time that had value. But, you know, that's when I think that when people look at the, you know, human sacrifice and they value that as something positive.
Well, no, absolutely.
And
I mean,
with your objectivism, like the fact that you guys talk about having a moral base, like for capitalism to replace the religious morality and the structure and the ethics, like he said, Sam Harris is a Christian, even though he's, you know, says he's an atheist because he doesn't go around killing people. I mean, this belief that everything is Christian because of the past, that we're all Christians, whether we think or not, like, and I know, well, he's, like, yeah, I totally agree. Like his fear of, like, breakdown of society is what he wants to keep all these traditions. So when people latch on to his gender thing, they love that. Or if Sam Harris talks about Islam, they people love that, but they don't understand that it's coming from a rational, like, just the overall, you know, search for the truth and reality. And a lot of people just grab onto one thing and they might have ulterior motives or religious backgrounds or whatever that they like to hear certain things, right?
No, I agree with you. And think about the fact that the ultimate sacrifice, right? The ultimate sacrifice, human sacrifice, is Jesus. Jesus on the cross dying for all of us. And he is, of course, in Jordan Peterson's terms, he is the, you know, the meta hero, the hero of all heroes, the essence of heroism. And why is he at the end of the day the essence of heroism, the essence of perfection, the essence of truth, the essence of order, is because he's willing to give up everything, right? To sacrifice everything. So yes, he has this strong altruistic element. At the same time, you know, when you listen particularly to psychological talks, he's also very interested in human flourishing. And people being successful and overcoming their psychological problems and overcoming their psychological fears and being successful in living and in life. And he talks about this. And so he has this contradiction, and all these guys do. I mean, Sam Harris has the greatest contradiction, right? He's anti-free will, and he believes in morality that can be derived from reality. He believes the Izzard gap doesn't exist. But yet he doesn't believe in free will. And how can he hold morality but not hold free will? And he believes in reason, but no, again, and I think the reason Peterson is likely to call Sam Harris more of a Christian. It's not so much that he doesn't, it's also that he doesn't go about murdering people, but also because Sam Harris's morality ultimately, this is why his politics is screwed up, is somewhat altruistic, right? He can't escape the Christian morality because it's all he knows. He can't use reason. He hasn't been able to use it to come up with an alternative to the Christian morality. So Jordan Peterson justifiably looks at him and says, yeah, in morality, you're just a Christian, right? Whereas Ayn Rand has discovered a whole new morality, an alternative to Christian morality, and a complete rejection of altruism, an alternative to Christian morality. So I think Peterson would still say we're religious in some sense because he believes the only reason... I mean, he has this Freudian malevolent view of human nature. It goes back to his Cain and Abel thing. We are murderers. We are committers of destructive activity. The nihilists, see, his view, I think this is true, his view is that nihilism is what's natural. Chaos, it's what's out there. The achievement is the rejection of nihilism, it's religion, it's philosophy, it's psychology. And that chaos and nihilism is the default. That if we just left people out there without religion, they would slaughter each other, then Cain slaughters Abel, right? It is Cain that slaughters Abel, right? Not the other way around. I think that's right. Anyway, so religion is what allows us to be human because it's what allows us to reject this nihilism, this animalistic. Think about it evolutionarily. It's the discovery of religion that destroys the animal within us. Right? I think he would agree with that statement. Something like that. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I think that I like to push the fact that we humans have a, you know, like you talked about with objectivism, where and even evolutionary psychology, where we had benefits to helping each other and trading things and exchanging. It doesn't have to be just because we're worried about going to hell or some Ten Commandments or whatever it is.
Well, the real value of being moral is that it benefits your life. That it's the only thing that benefits your life. That the moral is that which allows for human flourishing, and that which allows for human flourishing is what's moral. The moral is the practical is the moral. So, you know, it's how we interact with other people. Interacting with them in a just way is moral and leads to a flourishing life. It leads to success in life. It leads to good life. So, it's absurd that you need God in order to have morality. And it's absurd that the only morality possible is a morality of altruism. I mean, that's just all upside down. And this is what Ayn Rand does to a lot of philosophical thinking, is turn it upside down. I mean, she really challenges it. She really, really, really deeply challenges it. All right, thanks for calling. I really appreciate it. And I find it interesting that so many of you have listened to so much of Jordan Peterson. I can't blame you. I listen to a lot of him too because I find him fascinating. And this leads me to, you know, I think an important point, and that is, as objectivists, those of you are out there who are objectivists, I don't think everybody is, but many of us are. It is interesting to be confronted with alternative ideas. It's interesting to be challenged by those ideas. It's interesting to try to figure out what truth there is in these other people. I mean, as I said, I'm not a psychologist. I don't read psychology. I don't listen to psychologists. But I find a lot of what Jordan Peterson says about psychology really interesting. I mean, he had a whole thing about authenticity and what authenticity means. And a lot of it was kind of fuzzy and weird to me, but some of it was really true. And he talked about the fact that a lot of the ideas we hold in our mind, we don't actually own them, in a sense. This is some of my terminology. We don't really believe them because we haven't made them our own. In Ayn Rand's terminology, we're not first-handed about them. We have these ideas in our minds because our parents told us, because our professors told us, because we've just accepted it from osmosis from people around us. And, you know, and he says, wait a minute, to be authentic, an authentic human being, psychologically authentic, psychologically real, psychologically true, you have to make the ideas in your mind yours. So Ayn Rand would say, concretize them, you know, prove them, you know, make them yours in a first-handed way. Not yours because you heard Ayn Rand say them, not yours because you heard Yaron Brook say them or anybody else say them, yours because you understand them to be true, that you have proven them in reality to yourself, that you've reduced them to reality. You know, all the techniques that Rand and Peikoff have taught us on how to prove our ideas. And then I thought, wow, he's telling this to people, and this is great. He's telling them to be real to themselves, to confront their own ideas, to try to... Now, he doesn't really give them techniques to how to do that, but he talks about being really, you know, really, really authentic about that. Some other things that I wrote down here. You know, he's very attracted to Dostoevsky, which is fascinating, and makes complete sense. He loves Dostoevsky because Dostoevsky is exactly struggling with the kind of issues that Peterson, now he's a great writer, of course, but he also struggling with the same kind of issue. Can you have morality without God? And Dostoevsky is a very, very psychological writer. He deals deeply with psychology, with psychological questions and psychological issues. And when Jordan Peterson talks about psychology, it's often fascinating. You can tell he's read him, he's thought about him. It's really deep. Anyway, you know, there's a lot of, anytime I listen to him, I jot down notes. I think his interpretation of the Old Testament is fascinating. In terms of the kind of the psychological lessons he wants us to draw out of the Old Testament, that's where I find it interesting. His psychological observations about the purpose that these stories, the function these stories serve in people's lives. What have they learned from them? What have we, in a sense, culturally internalized from those stories? What is it about the structure of society and the beliefs in society today that comes from the story of Adam and Eve and other stories? And I think there's a lot there because these are ancient stories. We've told them over and over and over again. Every generation reads them. They have a huge impact. Stories, as we know, because we've read Ayn Rand's stories. Stories has a huge, both psychological and ideological, impact on people. And I think Jordan Peterson realizes that. So that's why he talks about the Bible as a story, as metaphors. And he talks about Dostoevsky a lot. And he really gets the role of literature and storytelling culturally and in shaping the individual's psychology and in shaping the individual's thinking. So, I don't know. I think that often objectivists don't read or listen or engage with ideas that are not objectivism. And I encourage you to do so. Now, be careful with Jordan Peterson. Don't get seduced. You know, keep a critical mind. Think about what he's saying. Test it against reality. Test it against your own knowledge. One of the concepts that he is really, really missing is objectivity. You know, at some point, maybe we'll bring on a philosopher to talk about what does objectivity mean and differentiating objectivity from subjectivism and intrinsicism. I think Jordan Peterson is clearly, strongly on the intrinsicist side of that trilogy, and he sees the danger of subjectivism, and that's great. What he doesn't get is the alternative of objectivity, of objectivism. And that's a tragedy. That's a tragedy of him, but it's more than him. It's a tragedy of our time. I mean, if you think about all the intellectuals out there, this concept of objectivity is really at the heart and center of so much of what we struggle with to try to explain. What are objective values when you talk about ethics, but even objective values when you talk about economics, when you're talking about with an Austrian economist, and, you know, kind of my area. You know, and you know, what does objectivity mean in epistemology? It affects everything. It affects what you, how you view the scientific method and what is the scientific method, how you view induction and how you view deduction. All of that is impacted by your basic fundamental views on epistemology. And this is where he fails. This is where objectivism has a huge amount, you know, to teach the world, and where I think we can get probably the most leverage by teaching it. It's not easy stuff. All right. Thanks all for listening. Hopefully you enjoyed the show. It wasn't kind of a classic show. We took a lot of callers. Hero, I'm holding on for a hero till the end of the night. He's gotta be strong and he's gotta be fast and he's gotta be fresh from the fight. Hi everybody. Gotta be strong and he's gotta be fast. Hi, everybody. Welcome. You're on Brook Show, Living Objectivism, episode, I don't know, 4, something like that. I appreciate everybody listening. Today, we have a pretty major task. Now, let me just, and we'll talk about that in a minute. Let me just note that we are streaming this on Facebook Live and on Periscope and on YouTube. I mean, this will be the standard now. Hopefully, with if the equipment all works and if the setup all makes sense, I'll adjust the camera. Hero, I'm holding out for a hero till the end of the night. He's gotta be strong and he's gotta be fast and he's gotta be fresh from the fight. I'm a hero. Hi, everybody. Gotta be strong and he's gotta be fast and he's gotta be fresh from the fight. Hi, everybody. Welcome. You're on Brook Show, Living Objectivism, episode, I don't know, 4, something like that. I appreciate everybody listening. Today, we have a pretty major task. Now, let me just, and we'll talk about that in a minute. Let me just note that we are streaming this on Facebook Live and on Periscope and on YouTube. I mean, this will be the standard now. Hopefully, with if the equipment all works and if the setup all makes sense, I'll adjust the camera just a little bit. So you can actually participate in a chat on Blog Talk Radio. You can participate in a chat on Facebook. You can participate on the chat in Periscope. Actually, let me open that up. I don't have that one up open. This is where I need another big live monitor. Maybe I'll get one. We'll see what happens. Launch. All right. We got now the chat from, and you know, some of you might know, we're going to talk about Jordan Peterson today, and some of you might have views and opinions about Jordan Peterson that are maybe even more informed than mine. So, to the extent that you guys want to have a conversation, feel free. You can also call in, which is even better. I'll try to monitor the chats, but if you want to call in with comments, I'd appreciate that. 347-324-3075. 347-324-3075. Particularly those of you who've kept track of Jordan Peterson, who've watched some of his videos. And if those of you who are, particularly those of you who are more knowledgeable of philosophy maybe than I am, because, you know,